with regards to all the reporting that's been done about Trump's views of Putin and views of Russia, Samantha Vinograd, what do we know for sure about what he's walking into? What do we know for sure about Trump's attitude?
Well, what we definitely know is that Trump and Vladimir Putin actually have a few things in common when it comes to the media. Both of them happen to be propaganda machines. They spread misinformation, disinformation, and sow divisions in the United States. That's Russia's mission, we know from the intelligence community. And Donald Trump has proven himself to be a tool, a Russian tool, for spreading that misinformation and disinformation. But we have to remember that Vladimir Putin has the upper hand when it comes to the media around this Helsinki summit. Remember, Vladimir Putin and the Russian government control most media within Russia. Russia is ranked 148th when it comes to press freedom. So we know that Vladimir Putin is going to be controlling the message out of Russian media. And we also know that the Russian government has very successfully manipulated social media to help spread the messages that they're seeking to get out. So Putin definitely has the upper hand in that respect. And he's also going to try to make Trump into a media maven because he knows that President Trump loves being in the spotlight and that when President Trump is in front of the cameras, he goes off script. He undermines the U.S. government. And again, he helps to spread Russia's messages.
I wonder what it means, if anything, that Putin has selected Fox's Chris Wallace to sit down with, to have an exclusive conversation after the meeting. It seems like Putin knows to go to Fox, but at the same time, Wallace is a really tough interviewer.
Exactly, but he knows that Fox is the president's preferred outlet, and he knows how to play his asset. And Donald Trump, either wittingly or unwittingly, is an asset of the Russian government. So if you're Vladimir Putin, you're going into this meeting and you're thinking, okay, I have my playbook. I'm going to flatter President Trump. He likes compliments. I'm going to talk to him about conspiracies within the United States. And I'm going to talk about things that he likes and things that he trusts, like Fox News. Imagine if Putin had said, no, I'm going to go give an interview to CNN or MSNBC. President Trump's spine would have been up. He would have been worried that Putin was going to say something that he didn't like. This way, President Trump is incredibly comfortable going into this meeting. And to use President Trump's words from a few days ago, he's easy. President Trump is an easy target.
You talked about him being an unwitting Russian asset. Jonathan Tate, you went a step further in your cover story for New York Magazine this week. We can put it on screen, I think. You talked about whether President Trump has actually been a Russian asset for decades. Now, you acknowledge this is unlikely, but you're making the point that it's possible.
Yeah.
Talk us through it.
Well, what I was trying to do in this story is to make the case that we've been behind the facts on the Russia story since the beginning. When the hack was first reported, nobody thought that Russia was actually trying to help Donald Trump. And we keep catching up, but we keep assuming the truth is just one or two steps ahead of us. And there's so much incriminating information. Much of it has been forgotten. One of the things I begin with is the fact that the former CIA director, John Brennan, received intercepts from European intelligence agencies of Russian officials talking about their connections to the Trump campaign. And then Brennan came out and said that he thinks Putin has something secret, some blackmail leverage over the president of the United States. That's an astonishing charge. And it's made by someone who actually has some information at his disposal. And I think we should actually take it seriously.
Is there a risk, Jonathan, that these kinds of conversations end up sounding like they're conspiracy theories? The same way that, you know, I say Sean Hannity's engaging in that kind of behavior?
There certainly is a risk. I mean, I think you have to be cautious about what the facts show. You can't get ahead of the facts. You can't say this definitely happened when you think, well, maybe it just possibly happened. You've got to look at other possibilities, as I do in every step I try to show where there could be an innocent explanation. Sometimes when someone does something that doesn't make sense, sometimes people just do things that don't make sense, and you have to be open to that. But look, when you've got serious information and you've got serious figures making these charges, I think you actually have to not just blind yourself to these outcomes that they're putting right in front of your face, but say, like, you know, this is one of the things that might actually be where the story is going.
I sometimes wonder if a lot of Americans have tuned this story out, this issue about Russia's attack in 2016, because it is so complex and it's become so partisan. Carl, is that something you've noticed, that the people, they don't want to keep track of all of these revelations, no matter how damaging?
Well, I think as in Watergate, a lot of the details are very hard to keep up with, even for reporters. But I think more important, we have just seen at the end of the week, on Friday, a tremendous development which puts an end to the fiction that the president, that Republicans in Congress, that Fox, that others have promoted about a witch hunt. What we now have, and we just heard Jonathan talk about and use the word might. Mm-hmm. I think that maybe we don't want to use the word might too much in our reporting, but we do want to assemble all the known facts that are there. And what we do know is that the Mueller investigation is going forward. We are seeing the president's narrative undermined by fact, not by might, but by what we know as a result of Mueller's investigation. And the attacks on Mueller's investigation by the president and his acolytes no longer carry the same kind of even prospective authority that they did several days ago.
Can I respond to what Carl just said?
Yeah, please.
I think you have to separate the jobs of a reporter and an opinion analyst like myself. Reporters need to just report what the facts are and put the facts together. Analysts need to base their analysis off of facts, as I do, but it's perfectly appropriate for someone writing an opinion article to say, here's what I think could be happening. Here's the range of possibilities.
I agree totally with Jonathan on that. And all I'm speaking about is that in terms of our reporting in terms of what we know, that it's the use of the word might can be undermining. But in terms of what Jonathan and what interpretive reporting and analysis is, absolutely, it has a place.
Samantha, how should folks here on television, you know, writing pieces as well, help keep the story straight for, you know, relatively casual news consumers who are not watching every single new development?
I think there are two pieces of this story that get a lot less attention these days. The first is the attack didn't stop in 2016. So Donald Trump is walking into this Helsinki summit, meeting with his attacker. We are under live attack by the Russian government. So this is not a meeting of equals. It's not even a meeting of rivals. It's a meeting of the attacker. And at this point, a willing victim, because the president has not done anything to really deter the attack from going forward.
Our president, if he is going to be the kind of responsible president that is called for in this instance, needs to push back to Putin and not give the kind of namby-pamby stuff that he said today, worse than namby-pamby, saying that this is fake news and this is rigged and the rest. The only thing that is rigged is the notion that he would go in there and not say to Putin, this must stop, there are going to be consequences, there will be more sanctions, there will be economic consequences, there will be more isolation of Russia. And what this meeting in Helsinki has to be about is stopping the conduct of Russia in terms of what we have learned in Washington in these past days.